as the night became explosive. Utilanta had ordered those who it had initiated and turned into monsters on the attack. The deputy director was furious that his men died at the hands of the monsters. With his deputies, they came to a conclusion that bullets can't hurt these monsters, but fire seems to be more effective, which was a plus for the FBI. Suddenly, they heard the monsters screaming at the top of their voices, which shook the ground, and it was frightening. Professor Dent got a call from his daughter, Mary, making him aware that she and her friends were on the 35th floor. Explaining their situation, the carnage she saw, how Terry saved her life, so the professor told them to come to the lower level of the building, in which it will be easier for the police in rescuing them, and asked to talk to Terry, begging him to do everything in his power to keep his daughter safe, for he is counting on him. And then the line went off. Terry, Mary, and Jackson heard the rushing footsteps and the scream of the monsters as they came running downstairs through the hallway. As they lie among the dead, not to be noticed, for this was the best way of avoiding the wrath of these monsters. As they got up from their lying position, a door swung open, and just right in front of them was their friends, Ashley, Gavin, and Rachel. Happy to see that their friends were still alive, their excitement was cut short as their friends, who are now monsters, launched and charged at them. The three ran as fast as they can from these monsters. On their way, Mary tripped due to a body on the floor. Mind you, those monsters were still coming from behind them. As Terry picked her up, she noticed an axe in a show glass, and immediately Terry got a hold of it. Just by his feet, Monster Ashley launched and dived towards Terry, and in defense struck her knee with the axe, which made her lose her balance. But Monster Ashley was persistent and again charged towards Terry, who used the axe to chop her head off. This was emotional for Terry, for Monster Ashley used to be his cousin, and moreover, he was the reason she came to the Empire State Building for his sent forth. So Mary dragged Terry up as they pulled a dead body away from the entrance of the lift. The door of the lift wouldn't shut as they forced it to close. Now, the problem at hand is that the lift was not operational, and quite frankly, they can't hide in there forever. But Terry had a better idea as he climbed to the top of the lift, as he used the axe in his hand to cut the cables so the lift can go down to the lower building. But as he was striking the cables of the lift, the banging noise caught the attention of the monsters as they ran towards the lift and tried to open the lift from the outside. Monster Gavin and Monster Rachel were trying their best to force their way into the lift. It was a struggle for Mary and Jackson, for their strength couldn't match the monsters, as one of them scratched and bit Jack on the neck and he bled out profusely. Then Mary dragged Jackson away from the unfriendly monsters as Terry successfully cut the cables in which the lift jolted and dropped downwards, cutting Monster Gavin and Monster Rachel's bodies into half, for they were by the entrance of the lift. Shouting out for Mary, Terry joined Mary, who was in shock, and they realized that Jackson was dead. This time, the FBI were prepared for the monsters as they ran out of the building on the attack, but was met with a surprise as they were sprayed with fire from flamethrowers by the FBI, which burned them to a crisp, and the FBI burned the lift hell out of the monsters. For this was phase one. Utilanta, feeling and knowing what was happening to its minions, commanded them to retreat. The deputy director wasn't taking any chances, for he observed that whomever these monsters attack die and rise to life again and start to attack the living, as the building was barricaded with fire. Now, there was bad news, for there was a weather report of a hurricane nearby, which was going to result in a very heavy rainfall, which may eventually quench the firewall surrounding the building. So in desperation, the deputy director had no choice but to go phase two. Then he ordered his men to retreat and move away from the building. As Mary could see all the cars and tanks backing away from the building, Terry understood that there is a possibility that they wouldn't make it out alive, and at this point tried to express his feelings on how much he loves Mary. But then the splinters in the building building began to flush out liquid. At first, they thought it was water, but then they began to perceive the smell, for it was gasoline, and had an understanding that the FBI was infusing the building with gasoline. The deputy director of the FBI asked the expert that when the building is ignited, how far will the fire spread? For he was being cautious so that the fire doesn't spread beyond the expected perimeter. For this was a desperate move, but he was out of options. Professor Dent, who got wind of the information and knowing what phase two is, tried to convince the deputy director of the FBI to warn his daughter of his operation, in which he refused to do, mainly because such move might cost them, for the next attack was meant to be a surprise. It caused a ruckus between the two as the deputy director placed the professor under arrest. Unfortunately for the police officer arresting Professor Dent, he shrugged him off and ran to a police van with an intercom, warning his daughter and Terry to go back upstairs, for their lives was in danger. In anger, the deputy director pulled out his gun, warning the professor to stop, but the professor was persistent as the deputy director was forced to pull the trigger. I can see.